Hello and welcome to this lesson, brought to you by BitMerge. This lesson is about transistors, the hardware component in computers that allow them to store and manipulate bits. We'll use a bit of chemistry to understand semiconductors and diodes, then use diodes to understand transistors. Understanding transistors begins with a bit of chemistry. Here is an atom of silicon with its 14 electrons distributed among three different shells. The outermost shell is called the valence shell, and it holds four valence electrons in a silicon atom. When silicon atoms are joined together, or bound to one another, they form a covalent bond in which one valence electron from each atom is shared among the two atoms. If we arrange silicon atoms in a lattice in which multiple covalent bonds exist, all neighbors share valence electrons. Since all electrons are used in this structure, pure silicon is a poor conductor of electricity. But computers need electricity to work. So, how do we achieve this? Impurities can be introduced into our silicon lattice to allow for conductivity. This process, called doping, commonly introduces boron or phosphorus into the lattice structure at random locations. The reasons for using boron and phosphorus are many, but we'll look at just one of the reasons. In their outermost valence shells, boron has one electron fewer than silicon, and phosphorus has one electron more than silicon. This gives us three atoms with three, four, and five valence electrons to work with. Since phosphorus has one more valence electron than silicon, doping silicon with phosphorus produces an extra electron wherever phosphorus appears in the lattice. This free electron does not give the entire structure an electrical charge, but does make it a semiconductor, meaning that it can carry a charge. For now, let's call this phosphorus-infused lattice of silicon an N-type semiconductor, or simply N-type material, because it can carry a negative charge. Boron, on the other hand, has one valence electron fewer than silicon, so doping silicon with boron produces a structure with missing electrons, or holes. This is also a semiconductor, which we'll call a P-type semiconductor, or simply P-type material, because it can carry a positive charge. If we place P-type material and N-type material back-to-back, we create a diode. In this diagram, the left half of the diode is P-type material, and the right half of the diode is N-type material. From this point forward, we'll abstract away the chemical details of the materials by using this green box to represent boron-doped silicon, and this red box to represent phosphorus-doped silicon. By the way, here's what a diode actually looks like. The place where layers of P-type and N-type materials meet, called a junction, is where some of the most interesting things happen. Because of the contact between the two semiconductors, holes and free electrons cross over into a small region of the neighboring material and cancel each other, leaving behind negatively charged ions on the P side and positively charged ions on the N side. This small region, known as the depletion region, keeps additional electrons and holes on either side from crossing over into the other side. If we take this diode and add some voltage, say with a battery, the depletion region shrinks and current is able to flow from the P side to the N side. If we take the battery and reverse the direction of its positive and negative sides, the diode actually prevents current from flowing between the N side and the P side, and actually makes the depletion region larger. Now we have all the information we need to understand transistors. A transistor is formed when a layer of N-type material is sandwiched between two layers of P-type material, or P-type material is sandwiched between N-type material. The results are PNP transistors and NPN transistors. Here, we'll only look at NPN transistors, as they're the most common in computers. The full name for this type of transistor is bipolar junction transistor. Let's look at how it works. From left to right, we call the layers the emitter, the base, and the collector. There are depletion regions between each NP and PN pair, preventing electrons from freely flowing, just like in the diode. If we introduce voltage and try to make a circuit by connecting the emitter and collector to opposite sides of a battery, electrons are able to get closer to the base but cannot flow across like they could in a diode. Electrons in the collector are attracted toward the positive side of the battery, and some leave the collector. To turn the transistor on, we introduce another battery between the emitter and base. This diode-like setup causes additional electrons to enter the emitter and creates additional holes in the base. The depletion regions get thinner, and electrons are able to cross. We end up with a large current flowing through the transistor from the collector to the emitter by applying a small current to the base, making the transistor an amplifier. We also have the ability to turn the current on and off, making it a switch. Transistors are the basis for modern computers. Connecting multiple transistors together through a series of logic gates allows us to store a single bit physically, as long as the power's turned on. In another video, we'll take a look at volatile memory in more detail and talk about the interactions between major hardware components of computers.